Hi everyone, it's me, Simon Jones. Some of you might remember me from the old school HitFilm tutorials from the before times, but because this is 2020 and it's lasted about 10 years, it's completely fine if you have no idea who I am. Point is, tutorials. Today we're going to be talking about fake snow and how to add it to a shot that doesn't have any snow.
Here's our snowy shot. We've gone full Narnia. Comparing it to the original, you can see how much has changed. Most of this was done using pretty simple matte techniques. The effect hinges around first generating a matte representing where the snow is going to be, then applying various filters to get the desired result. It's remarkably effective for something so simple. Okay, let's go through it. So here we have the original shot. If you want to shoot something yourself, make sure you film under conditions in which you get some good contrast range within the image. You want to make sure you've got some highlights, some brighter areas, as that will help to create the snow matte. It's fine to shoot on a grey overcast day like you'd get if it was actually snowing, but just make sure that you've still got that contrast and the highlights in certain areas. So the first thing to do once you've got your clip into a composite shot timeline is to duplicate it. The bottom layer is going to remain as our original, so I'm going to rename it Original Ground. The duplicate is what we're going to turn into snow, so I'll call that one Main Snow. We need to start isolating specific areas of the shot, which will eventually end up being where our snow is visible. How you go about doing this could vary depending on the shot you're working on. We're going to make use of the brighter areas of the shot, which fortunately tend to line up with where snow would naturally rest. I think this is because a lot of the lighting here is coming from the sky, and obviously snow also falls from the sky. That's just a little bit of weather education there. So I'm going to start off with a tint effect. I'm going to slap that onto the main snow layer, and it's already set to black and white, and I'm going to move the strength slider all the way up. So this cuts out all additional colours so that our snow is nice and white and we won't have any unwanted colour, but we will, once we've composited it, still have colour from the original layer peeking through. Now let's change the blend method on the snow layer, because we don't want the darker areas to be visible at all. So I'm going to switch this over to the lighten blend mode. What this does is compare the base color and the blend color, i.e. the layer underneath and then the layer on top, and then it retains whichever one is the lightest. This works better for this effect than, say, using screen or add blend, because they significantly boost the overall brightness. That's why they're really good for glows, lasers, lightsabers, that kind of thing. This isn't Kyber snow though, so we'll stick with a lighten blend. Now I'll add a curves effect. We're going to use this to compress down the layer's contrast range so that we only retain the areas we want to be snowy. This is a bit of an art rather than a science, and it will depend heavily on the look you're after and the nature of the shot that you're working on. Every shot's going to have a slightly different requirement here. So make broad adjustments at first and then gradually dial it in until you find what you're looking for. Next up, let's make this look a bit more like snow. I'll add a blur effect, and I'm going to drop that right down to a 2 radius, which softens the snow layer without actually making it look overtly blurry. Then I'll add a couple of glow effects, as snow reflects a lot of light and tends to bloom out ever so slightly in camera. I'm just going to use a couple of glows here to get the particular look I want, but obviously you can adjust that depending on what kind of thing you're after. Depending on your shot, you might have to do some further finessing. In my shot here, the sky and the background trees were blowing out and becoming far too bright, so I ended up masking off the top half of the shot and then adding an additional layer to handle the snow in the top half completely separately. Okay, so if we just fast forward a bit, here we have our completed snow-covered shot, and it's working pretty nicely. So let's move on to some falling snow. For this, we will of course turn to the particle simulator, but first, we have to get a 3D solve of the scene. And if you just let me be the ancient old guy in the corner of the room for a second, back in the day, this would have been pretty hard. Now, I just add the camera tracker effect onto the original ground layer and start tracking. Just for reference, I was 12 when the first Jurassic Park came out. That's why this stuff still makes me kind of giddy. Okay, so once that's complete, I'll solve the camera, then create the scene, which gives me a new shiny 3D camera to play with. Despite all the rolling fog in the source shot, the tracking is still really rock solid. which lets me do all sorts of silly things. Anyway, it's a good idea to set your ground plane so that you've got a good frame of reference. So I'll select a few tracked points which I know are sitting on the ground, and then I'll go to the Trackers on Canvas menu to set the ground to the selection. This doesn't have to be super precise, and we've got a kind of rolling hill going on here anyway, so it's not going to be perfect, but it is enough for what we're trying to do here. So now I'll add my particle simulator effect, knowing that the camera will now pass realistically through the falling snow. Inside the particle simulator, I'm going to use a quad shape emitter. This can sit right above our scene and drop lovely snowy particles. It's just like if you had a real rig up on your set dropping snow over your actors. I'll make the emitter nice and big to cover the area that we're moving through. And then in the appearance settings, I'll change to the built-in heavy snow texture, surprising no one. And in movement, I'm going to drop the speed down to zero. This is because I don't want the snowflakes to have their own actual velocity. It's not like the clouds are firing them out of cannons or something. So now I'm going to add a force to this particle effect. This is going to serve as our gravity. By default, it's a bit intense, and snow is actually pretty chill. So I'll just drop the direction strength down to 5 for a more gentle, sedate effect. I'll also add another force and switch it over to being turbulence. I'm going to keep this fairly smooth, and then again drop the strength right down, maybe to 10. I'm using this to add an element of randomness to the snow, because snow never falls straight down in a uniform manner. It has a tendency to get blown around by air currents. Turbulence is quite good at capturing that random chaotic behaviour. How much snowfall you actually want will depend on the needs of your shot, but the good thing is that once you've got the behaviour, the position sorted, and of course your 3D camera track, you can then very easily adjust the number of particles to get exactly what you're after. You can also change the gravity force or add additional ones if you want to give more of an impression of wind blowing in a particular direction. You'll also want to adjust the life of the particles so that they die out just as they hit the ground. Rather than doing this just by eye, you can actually check where they should disappear by switching out to one of the other view modes. Because we set our ground plane earlier, we know that the horizontal floor of our 3D scene does roughly match where the real ground is in the shot. So as long as my particles are finishing up around about then, it will look good. I also went into the lifetime panel and set the particle alpha to a gradient, which fades out at the end. This just stops the particles from disappearing abruptly and suspiciously at the very end, and instead they'll fade out and the audience won't even notice that it's happening. And that's just about all there is to it. I also put a slight blue-tinged grade on it as well, but otherwise this is one of those techniques which gives remarkably good results for surprisingly little effort. It's like when you find a recipe that takes 15 minutes to cook and only has 5 ingredients, but tastes like something from the best restaurant in town.
Hope you enjoyed the tutorial. Don't forget to hit the like button, subscribe to the channel, and click the notification bell so that you don't miss any of the great stuff coming up from FXhome. Until next time.